Leaving long ago, the emperor noticed in the midst of a veritable desert, pretty house built in a kind of green mound, an avenue of fig trees led up to it. And it was, as it were, overgrown with huge pomegranate trees and myrtles. Flowers abounded, and at the back was an orchard where grapes, lemons, oranges, guavas, and mangoes ripened together. A waterfall falling from a height of 200 feet and cascading merrily in its fall filled this corner of the garden with coolness and liveliness, and through a chink in the rocks could be seen half a league away Jamestown and the ocean. But from here, the ocean was not offensive. It did not oppress. It did not force its wild vastness upon one, and it consequence endlessly extend the confines of the dungeon. One would not go so far as to say that Napoleon would feel free there, but at least he could sometimes forget that he was not. But the house was inhabited by Mr. Balcombe, a merchant who, like most gentle merchants, provided the victualling of the vessels and bore the title of purveyor of the East India Company. He it was who was entrusted with providing all the necessary stores for the emperor's house, a duty he discharged to the best of his ability. Balcombe was at the Briars with his wife and two daughters, Jane and Betsy, two pretty blondes of shy, retiring disposition. The emperor was so reluctant to enter the town where he might have aroused the curiosity of the citizens that he considered himself happy enough to have found refuge 30 or 40 steps from the Balcombe's house in a little summer house, a kind of country box on a hillock where the family took tea on fine days. It had one room on the ground floor, almost square, 7 feet by 7, with two doors and two windows, one on each wall above an attic in which it was difficult to stand upright. Here he wanted to settle himself. An admiral who leased this little house to Balcombe at a distance set a guard of an artillery captain and two servants. Several days later, in order to lengthen the room, a fairly large tent lent by Colonel Bingham of the 53rd was erected, in curtains and various articles of furniture were brought along. But of what consequence was this to Napoleon? He could still dream he was at war and that he had bivouacked in one of the cottages to which victory had by chance brought him, and which for one night was called the Imperial Palace. He sent the Grand Marshal back to the town and instructed Las Casas to join him. These were fairly happy days, these days of campaigning, on which, to complete the picture, his attendants rolled up in their cloaks used to lie before the door, and where Las Casas and his son used to occupy the attic, which was filled with their two beds. What was worse than war was the food, two or three dishes, which during the first few days had to be brought up from Jamestown, where the cook prepared it. It was cold, and what made it worse, jolted about, mixed up. But Napoleon was at liberty to go into this garden where everything was new to him. He found jollity there, smiles of foolish questions and nonsense of the Balcombe girls. Their attractive beauty, their blonde tresses, the simplicity of young English children, petulant, unaffected, and at their ease. The latter did not displease Napoleon, who had always had a sort of sympathy for youth and even infancy. The severe hard time he had undergone while at school with his regiment, and finally the command, that life of poverty, which had not allowed him to indulge in even the amusements of his fellow officers, that life on half pay after the Toulon and Italian campaigns, then all of a sudden plunged into a storm of passion, that period of fame, that Icarian transition to the Almighty, that life had engendered in him a delight in playing and rambling about and listening to simple things and repeating them. He sometimes acted so with Josephine, with cousin Stephanie, and more especially with Marie Louise, who did not understand this levity, and the Mrs. Balcombe appeared at this moment, the right moment, with their Anglo-French jargon, their odd chronology, their comical questioning, and the horror they had for the terrible Bony, which might so easily have turned to affection. The day was spent at work with Las Casas, who at the Emperor's injunction had rejoined him together with his son, who was indispensable to the compilers. The Emperor, rising early, walked around the garden, breakfasted at 10 o'clock, and took another walk. Then Las Casas read to him what had been dictated the previous evening and recopied by morning by young Las Casas. The emperor then resumed dictation, which occupied him until 5 o'clock when he went out. At 6 o'clock, dinner arrived from the town. The evenings became tedious. Las Casas played neither chess nor piquet, and 6 hours of discussion followed by 6 hours of dictation had exhausted all subjects of conversation. Sometimes emperor remaining at table had his spoils brought in, which were scarcely less bulky than his equipment as an artillery officer, displayed the snuff boxes of portraits and medals, relating their stories. But very often, when in special need of distraction to escape the attention of Las Casas, who ceaselessly animated, greedily stored up all his expressions, tired of speaking only for the history, he used to spend the evening at the Balcombes, where he would play whist with the mother and the daughters. When the father had the gout, court language was not maintained, and the very silly questions were often indiscreet and usually fatuous. But his mind had to enjoy some relaxation from Las Casas. One does not quite know whether to hold the exaggerative memory of the narrator responsible for the frequent relation of facts not strictly true, or to put it down to the elaborations and mistakes which Las Casas certainly made in them, firstly in writing them and then in editing them for publication, and in inserting in consequence apocryphal paragraphs which made the authenticity of the entire work controvertible. Which was most provoking? It can be said that from this time, all the endeavors of Las Casas were most readily and amply directed towards what the emperor related and dictated of his public and private life, his military diplomatic career. So thoroughly was this done at the end of October 1815. He said, "We are ready at the end of the Italian campaign." This tete-a-tete, which was interrupted only by the appearance of the little Balcombe girls and by walks in the garden, which deserted by the military guards, had become for work and recreation an annex to the imperial country house, was no longer disturbed by unexpected visits. As in the early days, during that time, people, sometimes an admiral, sometimes a naval officer, used to come to the briars, knock at the door, even enter without knocking. This was not impertinence or ill will, but ignorance, so much so that the emperor took the opportunity of entrusting to Captain Desmond of the Redpole a note to England protesting against the strange steps taken against him. He once more declared that he could not be deemed a prisoner of war, that if he had chosen England, it was on account of the confidence he placed in her laws. Besides, he could not be a prisoner of war, for there was no war. And since laws of humanity had been violated in his case, the English government could resort to the custom of savages who put their prisoners to death. Such a law might have been more humane, more considerate than a justice which sent him to this dreadful rock. The death which he might have suffered on board the Bellerophon in the Plymouth Roads would, in comparison, have been a kindness. He concluded by saying that the first principles of Christian morality precluded his putting an end to his horrible existence, but that if the British government felt obliged to persist in its injustice and violence, the emperor would regard death as a distinct blessing. Such a state of mind was not unusual with him. He protested on principle and gave a political character to his protests, adhering to his opinion regarding the law violated in his regard, but he did not point blank stoop to complaints against locality, his subsistence, and his food. Every time, however, his companions in captivity came to Jamestown to visit him, he was depressed by their griefs and the bitterness of their recriminations. Had they sufficient influence over him to induce him to complain to the admiral, or did he think that it was useless to air protests in nature of which the admiral, despite the absence of ill will, could not possibly redress? Certain wants inconvenienced him greatly, and he might have sought some remedy. For instance, a bath, a carriage, and horses. But the admiral had already made his arrangements. He desired the disposal of his arms, and they had been returned to him. He desired also that he should not see his guards, and that he should move about the island at will without being accompanied. But that was contrary to the instructions received by the admiral. Finally, he requested that all his companions should reside near him, which would be convenient at Longwood, but was not possible at the Briars. He did not at least put his name to the document. The Grand Marshal, after considerable hesitation, many corrections, and the suppression of unseasonable details, drew up a note which he signed and sent to the Admiral. It still contained many superfluous words referring to Napoleon directly as Emperor, which caused Cockburn to reply that he was ignorant that there had actually ever been an emperor on that island, or that anyone possessing that rank had come with him on the Northumberland. Nevertheless, the Admiral protested his good intention. He could have given proof of it, except that since October 22nd, he had, by his orders, forestalled most of the requests addressed to him by the Grand Marshal. To demand contrary to his instructions, he could only reply by a peremptory refusal.